Okay, let me backtrack just a little bit so that you know where I was. So the question was, can we generalize ADS-CFT to theories of experimental relevance? And, well, thank you very much. So the prototype candidate should be low-energy QCD. So, as I explained before lunch, what we need to do is to relax the symmetry requirements in a controlled way, which gives us renormalization group flows. And we need to add more degrees of freedom, for instance, the quarks. And I also argued that we need to keep N to be large. Okay, and then, as I'm going to show you in some example now, is that so we need to break the conformal and the supersymmetry of the original correspondence. And so this is done on the field theory side by adding some mass term, for instance, to the theory. And so on in the dual gravity side, it means we have to deform the geometry. And this means that the fifth dimension of this anti-de Sitter space becomes an energy scale. And at the boundary, we're in the UV, and inside, we are in the IR. And the supersymmetry we break by deforming the S5 sphere. Okay, so then I showed you a simple way of, well, say, probably the simplest way, although it's still quite complicated, to adding quarks. So quarks were fields in the fundamental representation. So let me write down what I had before. So before we had these fields in the adjoint. And so they were transforming in this fashion. And now we want, so this is the adjoint. And now we want fields in the fundamental. And these will be our quark fields. Okay, so, and I told you that by putting these D7 rains, this was this figure, which was quite involved, we get these fundamental degrees of freedom on top of the ones of the NX24 theory. And so this is the dual to supergravity as before, but now we have this fundamental matter, which is dual to the Dirac von Infoult action for the D7 brain in the ADS5 times S5 space. So now I would like to show you two things. By combining this deformation of the background and adding the D7 brains, we can get a version of chiral symmetry breaking, spontaneous chiral symmetry breaking. And also, by looking at the fluctuations of this D7 brain, we can identify the meson masses. And so these two things we will do simultaneously. And since in the case of chiral symmetry breaking, we expect Goldstone bosons, I will show you that these mesons actually will be, some of them will be Goldstone bosons. Okay, so, and the symmetry which gets spontaneously broken in this model is this U1 axial symmetry, which is anomaly free in the large N limit. And so this will be spontaneously broken. So our Goldstone boson is really like the eta prime. But since it's pseudo-scalar, it still has some resemblance with the pi meson, the pi naught. Okay, I think that's where I got to before the break. So we get the meson masses from the fluctuations of the surface, so the D7 brain. And the pi meson, also the pseudo-scalar meson, the mass will come from the energy eigenvalues of the D7 brain coordinate fluctuations, whereas for the Rho meson, the energy eigenvalues will be given of the gate field fluctuations on the D7 brain will give us the Rho meson mass, so the vector meson mass. Okay, so, and so the way I entered all this game was with this paper in 2004, which I wrote when I was still in Berlin, so now it starts getting a really long time ago. And so these were my collaborators at the time. And so we had this paper called Chiral Symmetry Breaking in Pions and Non-Supersymmetric Gauge Gravity Duals. And well, this is my best paper. I think now it has something like 460 or so citations. And okay, so the idea is to combine the deformation of the supergravity metric with the addition of the brain probe. So I combine these two ideas, which I showed you. And this will provide a dual gravity description of chiral symmetry breaking and then also ghosts of bosons. Okay. So since many people here work in QCD, I think everybody will probably be familiar with this idea of spontaneous chiral symmetry breaking. So here you have, this is a famous Mexican hat potential. And essentially, you find that below a certain energy scale, there is a new ground state given by the quark condensate. Okay. So, and the spontaneous symmetry breaking means that instead of having this one vacuum here, we have a whole manifold of vacua which are along the circle here. And so the new ground state just picks one of them. And so since there is a zero mode going along this line, there should be a massless particle, which is the Goldstone boson. On the other hand, there's another mode when we go up and down and fluctuate in this. So if we fluctuate along the circle, then that's a massless mode. But if we fluctuate in these directions, since the second derivative is non-zero, this will give us still a massive particle. So we, and both of these we will recover in the gravity picture. Okay, so in this paper, what we did was to find a gravity realization of precisely this mechanism. And this, I would like to explain to you how we found this. Okay, so the mesomessons are obtained from fluctuations of this D7 brain probe in a confining non-supersymmetric 10-dimensional gravity background. And so this is what I've showed you before. So where we have our blue D7 brain in this very beautiful ADS5 times S5, but now I'm going to take a space which is not beautiful and symmetric, but it will have lots of wrinkles if you want. I mean, it will be a very complicated space. But this we have to do because chiral symmetry breaking is incompatible with supersymmetry. So if you have a chiral condensate, by default, this breaks supersymmetry. So if we want to see a chiral condensate in the probe limit, we have to break supersymmetry beforehand. Otherwise, we're never going to get such a condensate. Okay. So to see chiral symmetry breaking, we thus have to embed the D7 brain probe in gravity backgrounds to confining gauge series without supersymmetry. And so one example I'm going to show to you is the so-called Constable-Myers background. So this is in a paper of Constable-Myers from 1999, where they look at a particular deformation of ADS5 times S5. And this background has the property of breaking supersymmetry completely. And in particular, the deformation, which we are, I'm going to show you the formula in a second, the deformation introduces a new scale into the metric, which essentially we can then associate with our lambda QCD scale. And a nice feature of this model is that in the UV, the geometry returns to ADS5 times S5 with the D7 probe wrapping ADS5 times S3. This means, so if we are close to the boundary of our geometry, then again, we have still this very beautiful geometry. It's just we start moving inside along this flow, then this space and also this space will look less symmetric. However, the good thing is that we can still use the asymptotic expansion of our fields at the boundary to calculate, say, the quark mass and the quark condensate. Okay, so the general strategy of the calculation I'm going to show to you. So as I said, the dynamics of these quark, these little freedom here, in the dual, in the gravity case, is given by this Dirac-Mohn-Infeld action for a D7 brain embedded in this deformed background. And I think I showed this action to you yesterday already only 43 brains, now it's 47 brains. And so we have the square root of minus the determinant of the pullback of the 10-dimensional metric to this 8-dimensional world volume of the brain. And since the brain is charged, we also have a U1 gauge field here. Okay, so if we have a just one flavor, this will be just a U1. If we have two flavors, this will be a U2. Okay, now the strategy of doing the calculation for getting the meson masses is as follows. So first of all, since we have an action, we can use the Lagrangian formalism, just as everybody knows. And from the action, we derive the equations of motion. And in particular, we can derive the equations of motion for the transverse scalars, which later on they will be called W5 and W6. Maybe I should write down what the coordinates are called. You may see this. Okay. So these coordinates here, I call them x mu. And here, these coordinates, instead of calling them x4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, we call them W1, W2, W3, W4, W5, and W6. And remember, so the D3 brains precisely sits in these directions which we considered before. And so the D7 brain will be along these four directions, but also it will be in the W1, W2, W3, W4 direction. However, then it can fluctuate in these two coordinates because these are the coordinates where there's nothing. So then essentially this brain can bend into these two directions. Okay? And these coordinates tell us how the D7, so if we want to specify how the D7 brain is embedded in the gravity background, I have to give you the values of these two coordinates. Okay? So if you put something 8-dimensional into something 10-dimensional and to say precisely where it is, you have to fix two coordinates. Okay? So, and these coordinates will be W5 and W6. And so this pullback from 10 to 8 dimensions will give me this action, so will be a function of precisely these two coordinates. Okay. So this equation will give me the Euler-Lagrange equations of motion for these transverse scalars. Okay, since our background will be quite complicated, this means we get quite complicated equations of motion, and we have to solve them numerically. Okay, so using Mathematica, essentially. And the method of choice is the simplest method you can imagine, which is a so-called shooting technique. This just means you sit either at the boundary or in the interior, and you fix the two boundary conditions, and you shoot. And you hope that you get something regular. Okay, if your embedding, of course, goes off to infinity, then it's not stable. And okay, so shooting just means playing around with the boundary conditions until you get something which is regular. Okay. And so the solution then determines the embedding of the D7 brain. So it will tell us, so in this beautiful symmetric case, when the quark mass is zero, this configuration is precisely that this D7 brain sits here on this circle. But now if our space is completely deformed and not so beautifully spherically symmetric, then okay, this will wrap some much more complicated manifold, which we get as a solution of the differential equation. And so the solution of this equation will determine us how the D7 brain is embedded in this packet route. It's again the same as I mentioned this packet. The same action would also tell you how a soap bubble forms, I mean, the shape of a soap bubble in flat space. But now just imagine the shape of a soap bubble in something, you know, to be extremely down to earth. Maybe you know these boxes in which you can buy eggs, you know, which have lots of wrinkles. Okay. If you put your soap bubble in there, it's not going to be nice and round. It's going to be complicatedly shaped. But this complicated shape can also be deduced from solving the equations of motion for this action. Okay, so I should remind you that the basic technology is exactly what you learn in maybe in your second year undergraduate. Okay, we have an action, we have Lagrange equations, and we solve them. Okay, so this, conceptually, this is rather straightforward. Okay. Good. And now we have some freedom in how to choosing the bounding conditions. And for simplicity, we can set one of the two coordinates to zero. And then the other one will be a function of the radial coordinate here. Okay, so this variable rho, which I have introduced there, this will be the radial direction in these four directions. And so this will be the radial direction, there will be rho, and rho we can just write as w1 squared plus w2 squared plus w3 squared plus w4 squared. Okay? So, and then of course, if we call so r squared, the ADS radial coordinate will be rho squared plus w5 squared plus w6 squared. Okay? Okay. Then, so the solution of this equation of motion will then tell us how the D7 brain is embedded in this complicated background as a function of this variable rho. Okay, this one. So this radial direction in parallel to the D7 brain. Okay, and now if we would like to calculate mesons, I argued before that the meson masses correspond to the energy eigenvalues of fluctuations about this equilibrium configuration. So this means we look at small infinitesimal deviations of this solution. Okay, so this is the background we obtained. So this is some function, non-trivial function. And then we just allow W5 and W6 to fluctuate. Did my microphone go off? Or is it still okay? Yeah, okay. So then we have to look at these fluctuations. Okay, so this means we take the solution, add these deformations, and plug it back into the action again, and then we get the equations of motion for the fluctuation, and we just consider, because they're infinitesimal, we just consider the linearized equation. Okay, and then we solve these linearized equations of motion. And so I have to say a few words on the boundary condition. So and essentially for this W, for both of the W's, we may make an ansatz where we take some function of rho. So this is the ansatz for these fluctuations. And then we take a plane wave in the four directions parallel to the three brains, so in our real world dimensions. And then the meson mass is obtained by saying that the square of this, so this is just the Einstein relation, where the square of this vector should just be m squared. Okay. And so this will be the meson mass. Okay. That will be the equation in shortly. Okay, but first I have to say a few things about the boundary conditions. So Remember yesterday I told you about this field operator map, and we expanded a scalar field near the boundary of the anti-de-Sitter space. And in this expansion, there was a leading and a subleading term, which in the coordinates chosen, there was a normalizable and a non-normalizable solution. And the leading non-normalizable term was identified with the source for this operator. And the subleading term was identified with the vacuum expectation value of the operator. So maybe let me just recall this equation, because I wrote it yesterday. So remember, so was a minus sign here, I think. Yesterday I wrote this equation. Okay, so where delta was the dimension of the operator, and this is the source. And then, so this is a purely quantum field theory expression in 3+1 dimensions. But then in ADS-CFT space, we continue this. So this is our anti-de-Sitter space. And so we have an insertion of this operator here, say. Then it couples to the source, and we let the source now propagate into the space. So then there will be some phi, which depends on x. And I think I used z yesterday. But the boundary value of this phi will just be this phi naught again, which only depends on x. Okay, so the source, the boundary value of this supergravity field, which propagates in this xy dimension. And then also, yesterday I told you then, of course, this phi will be a solution to the equations, the Einstein equations of motion in the gravity space. And if we, so the asymptotic solution, for the gravity, for and asymptotic means near the boundary. Near the boundary, we had that our phi becomes something like this. So there was the source term, and here there was this non-normalizable mode. And then the subleading term was the vacuum expectation value. And this was a normalizable mode. And then there are the subleading terms. Okay, so that's what I told you yesterday. And now we apply exactly this ADS-CFT procedure to the coordinates of our embedding. Okay, so now the solution to our complicated equation of motion will have a leading and a subleading term. So there's a slightly different coordinate system, which involves this r instead of z. And it also means there's an exponential there. And here we only have powers, but that's just a choice of coordinates. And if we apply this, yesterday I said this rule was due to Gupta, Ivanov, and Polyakov. And if we apply precisely this general ADS-CFT rule to our embedding coordinates, then we see that near the boundary, the source term is actually a quark mass, or the quark mass. And the subleading term here, the C, will be the quark condensate. Okay. Now, what we are after is we would like to see spontaneous symmetry breaking.
Six, right?
Sorry?
This is delta W6, right?
No, no, this is not delta. This is W6 itself. It's the background solution.
Okay, so this is the embedding?
The embedding coordinate. Okay, so, okay, oops, sorry. Yeah, good that you're asking. So, maybe I should tell you. So, if we are in the supersymmetric case, so I told you before, in a supersymmetric case, there can't be any spontaneous symmetry breaking. And this means that C must be zero. So if I'm in the supersymmetric theory, then it's exactly this picture with my beautiful ADS 5 as 5 with this blue surface inside. Then I can plot the embedding coordinate as a function of this rule. Okay. And in that case, when it's supersymmetric, this will just be flat lines like this. Because at the boundary, so here, at the, and this will be correspond to this M. Oh, sorry, I'm on the next page. Okay, so essentially, we will just have, okay, this is a different coordinate system. That's why you can't compare it directly, but so there will just be a source term, and in suitable coordinates, this will just be constant. And this term in front of the subleading term has to be zero because supersymmetry dictates that this has to be zero. This means in the supersymmetric case, these things can't bend. Now, if we break supersymmetry, and this is exactly what I'm about to do, and I will show you, this will be no longer the case. And in fact, the interesting thing is that these curves will bend. They will do something like, okay, it should be a fun, like this. And essentially, what you can think of is that there's some region of very high curvature here, which pushes away these embeddings. And then now what we are after is, okay, so when M is not equal to zero, then we get an explicit breaking of the U1 axial symmetry. But that's not really what we want. We want a spontaneous breaking. So if we want a real Goldstone boson which is massless, then M should be zero, but C should be non-zero. So that's the solution we are after. So this means if M is zero and C is non-zero, it should go all the way to zero here. But then if C is non-zero, it should start bending and have a behavior like this. So that's what we are after. And I will show you how we get actually such a curve. But following your question, at the moment, I'm just talking about the embedding. Okay, it's no fluctuation here. Oh, no. Okay, sorry. This is geometry. This is, okay, sorry, very good that you asked. The coordinate here, sorry, I should have put rho, is a coordinate. So I'm talking about geometry, okay? So it's the dual geometry to my quantum field theory. So I'm doing a gravity calculation at the moment, okay? So, and actually, in everything I'm doing here, there's no, so far I have set the temperature equal to zero, but soon there will be a scale, which for some reason is called B. In some equation you will see a B, and this B you can think of as lambda QCD, essentially. Okay? So the temperature is set to zero, and these curves, okay, it's really important that you understand what this is. This is the coordinate in the 8, 9, so this is this coordinate as a function of that coordinate. And when it's not flat, then near the boundary, we can have an asymptotic behavior where it goes to zero. So this would then, according to these laws of ADS-CFT, means that the quark mass is zero. But since it's not entirely flat but bended, there's a subleading term, and this means the condensate is non-zero. So this means we get chiral symmetry breaking because the condensate is non-zero. Yeah, very good. This is this Gell-Mann-Oaks-Renner relation. This will come, yeah, okay. You're in 5 transparencies.
Sorry, just I'm a little still confused. So you, in the last lecture, you said that there's the fluctuations of the D-brain that gives the masses and all these things, right?
No, it gives the masses of the mesons, but at the moment I'm talking about the mass of the quarks.
Okay,
okay, good question. So this M is the mass of, the bare mass of the quark. And this capital M, this is the mass of the meson. Okay, two different objects. Okay. Okay, so we are looking for a solution of our complicated 10-dimensional geometry where one coordinate is a function of another coordinate in such a way that it has such a particular asymptotic behavior which tells us that we don't have a quark mass, but we have a quark condensate. That's what we're after. And then we get a spontaneous breaking of this U1 axial symmetry, which is geometrically realized here. Yeah, yeah, everything I'm doing so far is one flavor, yeah. Okay. Okay, so let's put some equations. Okay, so far I was telling you about AD is 5 times is 5, okay, for which I wrote the metric yesterday. But okay, I said this is too beautiful, we can't get chirosymmetry breaking in this metric. So now let's take this much more complicated metric, which is the so-called Consable-Myers deformation. And so essentially on the field theory, you also start with NX24 super young mid theory, but then you deform it by a vacuum expectation value for trace F squared. That's something pretty drastic to do in a supersymmetric quantum field theory, and that really breaks supersymmetry completely. So you get a non-supersymmetric QCD-like field theory. Okay, I told you before that there's still lots of adjoints, fermions, and scalars, but once you break the supersymmetry, then by quantum corrections, they actually become very heavy and they decouple. So essentially, you get a free gauge theory with this strange web in there. Okay, so now instead of our nice ADS 5 times is 5 metric, we get something more composite. H is a function of this expression. So delta is some particular parameter which is set to some particular value. And okay, so you see this is the argument of this function, and so that's the function itself. So it's, okay, it's not super simple, but so these are the four x coordinates written here, okay? And this W are the four coordinates for the x are those, and the six W's are those directions. Okay, so this is our 10-dimensional metric. And now there's this constant B, which we didn't have before. And this constant B is related to lambda QCD, essentially. It's a scale which breaks both the supersymmetry and the conformal symmetry. Okay, and since it's a supergravity solution, we also have a running dilaton, which then means that our beta function is no longer constant. So we break the conformal symmetry, we have something which runs. And then there's also this C4, this we also had before, this fourth form. Okay, and then you can check that this background has a singularity when W, which is essentially, I think it's essentially R, then is equal to B. And so the singularity in this diagram will sit precisely at the origin here in this coordinate system. And then if you have a singularity here, it means that there's a region where the curvature is large. And this means that all these brains, they have to bend away from this region. So there's a repelling potential, if you want. Okay, so you see the calculations become a little ugly, but with Mathematica, you're still very much on top of it. Okay, so the important point is that if we want a comparison, now it's too loud. since we want a comparison with QCD, we need a duality to a confining gauge theory because QCD is also confining. And actually we can show that this background which I just showed to you actually is dual to a confining gauge theory. And the way you can check that it is because you can calculate the Wilson loop in this theory. And the Wilson loop displays an area law. So now how do you calculate a Wilson loop in a dual geometry? Well, the idea is it's very similar to this entanglement entropy, which I discussed earlier. So essentially, you have to calculate the area of the minimal surface in the dual geometry, which is ending on the loop. And so this is already also some early result of Malacena, who showed this that precisely the area of the surface will give you this Wilson loop. And it has all the properties which you like. So it has an area law in a confining background, and in a conformal field theory, it goes like a Coulomb potential. Okay, so by calculating the Wilson loop in this way, we can actually check that this is a confining gauge theory. Okay, so now here is the numerical result of solving the equations of motion for this embedding, okay, for this metric. And so if we now put a D7-Rayne in this metric and we write the Dirac von Infeld action, so essentially we take this metric, and for this metric, we calculate, and there it was, sorry, this action. So G is precisely this metric on the next page, this very long metric. And then we calculate the pullback to the world volume of the D7-Rayne. And then we just do exactly this recipe, which I showed to you earlier. And then we have to solve. So at some point it said solve numerically, okay? So it says solve equations of motion numerically. So that's what we did. And here's the result, okay? So I said you use this shooting technique. So this diagram is the same coordinates as the things I, so okay, this diagram is essentially similar to that, or I should say this is similar to the numerical result, which I'm about to explain. And so the coordinates are the same. So this here we have a rho. So the rho is this rho, which is the radial direction in the 4, 5, 6, 7 direction. And W6 is this embedding coordinate, is this coordinate. Okay. And so now we have to choose our boundary conditions nicely. So I told you now that in this region there is a singularity. So now when we choose the boundary conditions, we certainly don't want a solution which hits the singularity. So this is certainly very ugly and unphysical. Also, we don't want solutions running off to infinity because these blue lines here, they correspond to constant values of R. So R is this R. So R is the radial coordinate in the entire anti-de Sitter space in the 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 directions. And I told you that in our RG flow, this is the energy scale. And okay, so if I plot W6 and rho like in this way, because on essence this omega 5 is 0, and obviously I see that my R is going to correspond to a circle. Okay, so and these are these circles which you see here, and so I don't want a solution which goes twice, intersects a circle twice, because otherwise it's not an RG flow. I start at the UV, I flow to the IR, but then I go back to the UV. I mean, that's not really what we want. Okay, we want an RG flow which starts in the UV and it goes all the way to the IR, but it shouldn't hit the singularity. Okay, so and then that's how our shooting method works. So we take this blue, this good solution. So we choose the quark mass. And then by the shooting technique, we look at the case where here the first derivative vanishes, because then we have something finite. And then we have two boundary conditions for the solution of a second order equation. So this means everything is determined. And then we can read off the value of C. And C is our condensate. And then in doing this, that's the solutions we find. And we start with rather big values of the quark mass. So they are all given in units of this B here, actually. And then you see we take the quark mass to be smaller and smaller. And at the same time, our result, so then we get brains which curve more and more away from the singularity. And at the same time, the C becomes bigger and bigger. And if I plot the C versus, so this is the condensate versus the quark mass as obtained from these boundary conditions here, then I see that if the quark mass goes to zero, I get a finite value for the condensate. Okay, so we have a spontaneous breaking of the U1 axial symmetry, because when the quark mass goes to zero, the condensate is non-zero. So the boundary conditions on our embedding determines whether we have chiral symmetry breaking. And now, okay, so this was your question. Yeah. So now we do the next step, and this was also what you asked. So far I talked only about W6, and now I'm going to talk about delta W5 and delta W6. And so I look at the fluctuations of this probe brain. So, now, on this axis, I put the quark mass, and the quark mass in the same way as before. So, oops, sorry, I'm going the wrong. So, okay, so the quark mass is the source, the leading term in this asymptotic behavior. And here I plot the meson mass, which I obtain by this method I have explained here. I make an ansatz for these delta W's, which is a function just depending on this variable rho. And then I put a plane wave in my field theory direction. And the four vector squared will be equal to the meson mass. Okay, so it's just the energy eigenvalue. And since I have two fluctuations, W5 and W6, it means I will have a pseudoscalar in the scalar mode. So the pseudoscalar mode is the Goldstone boson, which you really nicely see here. Okay. And this other mode is called a sigma meson, I think. So this is a meson which corresponds to the fluctuations in the Mexican hub potential, which go up and down, not along the vacuum manifold, but in the other directions. And so these fluctuations, they are massive. Okay. Okay, and then what we nicely see is that here we have a square root behavior and they're very closely to zero. And this actually confirms the so-called Gell-Mann-Ochs-Renner relation, which is a relation already from 1968. And essentially that says that the meson mass should be proportional to the square root of the quark mass and then times the condensate. So, and then the next leading term is for vanishing condensate, then it's going to be linear in the quark mass. So here we need to see this nice square root behavior as expected from the Gell-Mann-Ochs-Renner relation. So it's really reassuring that we see what is expected. But then if we go to very high quark masses, okay, so the higher we go up here, well, maybe I should go back. you see the higher we go back, the more these blinds get flat again. And when they're flat, then we are back in the supersymmetric case, and then the condensate vanishes. And this means that after a while, we return to a linear behavior, as we see here. Okay, so this is outside the confining region. Okay, so it's really a Goldstone boson because the meson mass goes to zero and the quark mass goes to zero. And it satisfies this famous relation. Yeah? Yes. Well, the quark mass, so the quark, the bare quark mass and the condensate are two independent parameters. Yes. Okay. So now what is very nice is that we can compare this result to lattice gauge theory. I mentioned that at the end, just before lunch. And so this is really a calculation. So this is our results here. And so there was a group of lattice gauge theorists that really required quite some advance of lattice gauge theory because you need to take the large N limit and you have to look at quarks, and both of them are very costly in terms of computer time. Okay, but so what is shown in this graph? Okay, so what we see here is the rho meson mass. And here we see the pi meson mass or this eta prime meson mass, if we want. Yeah. At the moment, I'm using one flavor, yeah, but I'm. How do I differentiate between? Well, yeah, because this is a pseudoscalar and this is a vector particle. So the pseudoscalar I get from the fluctuation of the coordinate, and the vector I get from the fluctuation of the gauge field. Okay, so I distinguish them by their Lorentz transformation properties. So okay, so this pion, which really is an eta prime, is obtained in exactly the way I was saying before from the fluctuations of this W6. Okay, maybe I should go back to, I said this before, but maybe now it becomes more, yeah, okay. So the the pseudo-scalar meson mass is from the fluctuations of the D-brain coordinates. The rho vector I get from the fluctuations of the gauge field. Okay. Okay, so now I plot the function, the mass of the rho as a function of the mass of the pi meson squared. Okay. And I can dial the mass of the pi meson by dialing the mass of the back walk. I mean, the real parameter is the back walk mass, but then I just calculate these two things. Okay, then the result we get in ADS-FT is this black line. Okay. It's essentially linear for quite a range. And now we want to compare to lattice gauge theory. So these dots here, these are the lattice gauge theory results. And of course, if you want to compare two calculations, you have to fix one scale. You know, we have one parameter in our model, which is essentially lambda QCD is the parameter. So we have to make it equal in the two models, otherwise we can't compare. And so that's what we're doing here. So by choosing the value of the rho meson mass at really vanishing pi mass as our scale, so we divide the rho mass by the rho mass as vanishing pi mass, and we divide by the same scale here. Okay, so then we can compare dimensionless quantities. Okay, so this is why this line starts at one. Okay, because this is just we divide.
So you have just up or down, but still then you can create.
Yeah, yeah, okay. So it's essentially at the moment a one flavor model, but I mean, by just little abuse of notation, you can call this a rho and a pi because the one is a vector meson, the other one is a pseudo scalar meson.
Bar kind of thing.
So I didn't hear.
The pion will consist of U, U bar kind of thing.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. Yeah. That's right. Mm-hmm. Okay, we have only a pi zero. There's no pi plus or pi minus. Okay. Good. So, as I said, what we get is this black line. Now, our colleagues, the lattice gauge theorists, they also did the same calculation. So in lattice gauge theory, what do they have to do? Well, it's very hard to do large N in a lattice gauge theory. So what they did was to extrapolate, you know, so these different colored objects refer to a different number of colors. So they start at 3 and then take 4, 5, 6, 7, and 17. I'm not sure why they take 17 colors. Okay. And now, unfortunately, what doesn't show very well in this figure is that there's a gray triangle, which I think you can't see, probably, which is the region of extrapolation of large N, which they get from the systematic extrapolation here. The good thing that our ADS-CFT line is right inside this region, okay? So it's very nice because, this black line I really get by doing a gravity calculation. So I have a complicated action and I write down the equation of motion. I look at these fluctuations and that's how I get my masses, meson masses. And these people, they really take large N QCD and they simulate on the lattice. And well, I really would like you to be impressed because it really looks very similar. Okay, I mean, at first there's no reason why it should be so nice. And so this is really impressive, and this is one of the, of course, since we started with a conjecture, for us it's quite hard to explain why this agreement is so nice. But it's reassuring, it is. And this is a very good result, and we can also make it quantitative. So essentially, if we look at the first derivative of our line, so just how, you know, the slope, how much it grows, then in these units, it's 0.307, okay? And the lattice gauge theorist, the slope they get is this. Okay, for, again, for us, it's very hard to find a systematic error. I mean, because it's not really clear what we should change to find an error. I mean, you can look at different gravity models, but I mean, there are not so many of them where this works. And in any case, so this result matches extremely well with that result. So this is very beautiful because really in large N QCD and this large N lattice gauge theory results seem to coincide. Okay, now, as I said, it would be nice to understand why it works so well. And I mean, in full generality, we can only explain this once we understand how ADS-TFT works, but I mean, we can make some plausibility arguments. So let me show these to you. And these come here. Okay, so essentially, as turned out later, I mean, maybe if you're a bit familiar with ADS-CFT, so this paper I showed to you was from 2004, but then in about 2007, 8, 9, people started also to look at superconductors in ADS-CFT. And there's also obviously something in condensing. And it actually turns out this mechanism of condensation in our model and these superconducting models is actually very much related. It just means that a certain mode becomes tachyonic for a while. And so it's actually to see this feature in general is actually enough to expand the deep brain action to quadratic order. So that's what's done here. Now X is this embedding coordinate. So X is, this capital X is the same as we had for this W64. So if you just have this action, and then it captures all the physics you need to get this chirosymmetry breaking. Okay. So to understand a little bit better what happens, we together with Nick Evans again, who was also on the other paper, we came up with some phenomenological model, which just, so it's a bottom-up model, which just captures the essential features of this chirosymmetry breaking model. So we take this very simple metric, which you can, well, it's much simpler than this Constable Myers, which I showed you before. And again, we take the fluctuations. Okay, now, we take them to be a little more complicated as before, but essentially it still boils down to this here. And okay, so you really see that it's essentially to make a shift of the mass of this scalar X in such a way that it becomes tachyonic. And to make contact with QCD, we just know, so before I told you, yeah, I told you yesterday that the mass of the particles is related to the dimension of the dual operator. Now, the dimension of the dual operator in QCD gets modified by the anomalous dimension, which to first order is written here. And so we take this now as a phenomenological approach of modeling the change of the mass of the dual gravity particle. So we take this QCD result and by hand just plug it into our gravity action. Okay, and so let me just show the results. So again, the black dots is the ADS-CFT result. And all the other dots are some lattice. So these, okay, I should say, okay, let's be more careful. The black dots are the Constable Myers result in the 10-dimensional approach I showed you before. Okay, so these black dots are the same as this black line in this graph here. Okay, so it's this black line now appears as these black dots. And now we do calculation in this phenomenological model. Oops, sorry. Where now we dial, so we take this n as a parameter and just put some values and see what happens for different values of this anomalous dimension. And you still see, well, it's not very far. I mean, first of all, it doesn't vary very much if we vary this mass term. And so these are the lattice gauge theory results for SU3, SU5, and SU7. These are the squares, so these are a little on top. They're a bit higher than our results. Okay, so, but they all still seem to be well, quite close to each other. So it's important to notice that although it's nice and linear at the beginning, at the end, this will actually start to curve up. And also an interesting fact is that somehow this is SU3 for the lattice, this is SU5, and this is SU7. So SU5 is, or SU7 is again closer, SU3 is even closer, so it's not really that if n becomes bigger that you get closer to this line, which is also a bit surprising. Okay, but the upshot of this figure is that essentially it's not very far off, and there seems to be something universal again about this behavior. And okay, so that's what I mentioned this morning when I was talking about the shear viscosity. I mean, ADS-CFT is very good at uncovering these universal features, and this is another example of this. And so one reason why there's this universality is in the following. So here, I'm just plotting the anomalous dimension, which enters as a parameter. And for the Comstable-Myers, it's essentially this blue curve. And for standard Young-Mills theory, when n goes to infinity, it's this red curve. And they are quite different in the UV. Okay, so now this is actually the energy scale. So sorry, it's again in rho, but this rho is not the same rho as that rho. I mean, it's essentially just an energy scale. And in this region, okay, so where the confinement occurs, they're actually almost parallel to each other. And it appears that it's only this IR behavior of this anomalous dimension which seems to enter in the calculation. And that's probably a reason why it's so universal. Okay, so on one hand side, this result is extremely reassuring. Sorry, but fast. It's extremely reassuring, but on the other hand, it still leaves lots of open questions. I mean, yeah, why does it work so well? And ADS-CFT seems to capture universal features, but I mean, certainly there's still many open questions to understand the mechanisms which are at work here. But of course, this is strongly coupled. The P3 side is not so easy. Good. Okay, I think that concludes everything I wanted to say about this D3D7 model. So maybe if you have further questions about this. No. Okay. Good. So now I wanted to move a little bit to this other model, which is this called Sakai's free motor model. And so since Tony Rippon is here, I should mention him because he's been doing lots of work on this model. I should say I never actually wrote a paper on this model, so I can tell you what it is, but I never calculated anything. So this model is, instead of D3 brains, it has D4 brains. And instead of the D7 brains, it has D8 and D8 bar brains. And so it was proposed by Sakai and Sugimoto in December of 2004. And the nice thing about this model is that instead of just breaking this U1 axial symmetry, it has the full SU3 times SU3 flavor symmetry spontaneous breaking to the diagonal subgroup. So that's exactly what happens in QCD. So in that sense, the model is more realistic. On the other hand, there's a slight disadvantage as compared to what I was doing before, because you can't dial the quark mass so easily. It's not such a nice interpretation to the quark mass. And the reason for this is that these D4 brains really, in the ultraviolet, they lead to a five-dimensional theory, not to a four-dimensional theory. So the model is very good in the infrared, where everything is four-dimensional, but outside, it's further away from QCT. But anyway, I think I should tell you very briefly what this model is. MKK, so where MKK stands for Kaluza-Klein mass, well, you know, this identification obviously sets a length scale and also a mass scale. Yeah. You can also write this mass scale in terms of a radial coordinate in the following way: 3/2 RKK to the 1/2. So this will be a radial particular value of the radial coordinate similar to the horizon in the black hole I showed yesterday. And the anti de Sitter radius also enters. Okay, So essentially now you get a kind of cigar-like geometry. And so what happens is the geometry will be such that this x4 coordinate is wrapped in a circle s1. And now if I here I plot my radial direction, then there's a particular scale rkk, which is this scale, where this will shrink to a point. So I have this kind of cigar-like geometry. And now the idea is that instead of putting the 7 brains, we put NF D8 and D8 bar brains. So D8 bar brains are the same as the D8, but with the opposite charges. So in some sense, that's the antiparticle of this object. So they actually, if they get close to each other, they actually annihilate. And these, they will be put, so these are 9-dimensional objects. And they will be in every direction. Except this compactified one. So this means if you're in the UV on the circle, one of them will sit here and the other one will sit there. Okay, now each of them, so if you say you put 3 of the D8, so this will be the D8, say, and the D8 bar. And if you take 3 of these and 3 of those, then you get this SU3 times SU3 flavor symmetry. And the chirosymmetry ranking now happens very nicely, because if you embed the geometry in the same way with all the calculations we did before, then they will actually start bending. And at some particular point, they will join. Okay, and this scale is called R0, I think. Okay, so now this is our chirosymmetry breaking. Because here, instead of just having, at this point, they touch. So instead of having an SU3 and an SU3 here, here we will only have one of them. So the diagonal subgroup survive. Okay, so let me, maybe I should quickly write the metric for this geometry. So, so the metric of the background for the before brains will look like this. So L again is our anti de Sitter radius, and R is the radial coordinate. So then again, we have our Minkowski in 3+1 dimensions. But then we have now this fourth coordinate with some function of R in front of it. So dx4 is the coordinate which I put in brackets over there, because it's this compactified coordinate. And then the remaining coordinates, they get a different prefactor. And then again, we have a sphere, and in this case, it's a fourth sphere. Yeah. Okay. So now this function is very similar to what we saw for the black hole yesterday, except it's not in a time direction. So yesterday, we had such a factor in front of the time direction in the Minkowski metric. And now it's a factor in front of this extra spatial coordinate. And but the form of the factor looks very much like the blocking factor in the black hole geometry. Okay, so and then to study mesons and fluctuations, one looks at the DBI action again for this T8 brain. So there will be the tension for the T8 brain, and then integral over this 8 plane with 8 coordinates. And essentially then minus the determinant of the pullback of the metric to this work version, the brains. So that's all very similar to then what we did for the D7 brains. Okay, but now since this extra coordinate is embedded, is identified and all the 8 other directions are filled, it's a bit different how you identify your scalar field. And essentially what happens is that the phase of the gauge field in this tensor on the 8 brains is identified with the core condensate. So that's a bit different from what we were doing beforehand. And that's because at infinity, the theory becomes 5-dimensional, because then essentially this 4-dimensional coordinates unwraps against. Anyway, so I won't go into many details of this model, but let me just say that lots of beautiful physics has been done with it. And one example is what you can do in this model, which, in the D7, I showed you this nice comparison to lattice gauge theory. But here, what you can do, you can actually compare to real values in the particle data book. And you can, for instance, look at the ratio of the A1 particle and the Rho meson. And that's actually very close to experimental value. So you can look this up in the particle data book. And to very good accuracy, it coincides with the experimental value. Okay, and there's many other nice things you can do with this model. You can put magnetic fields, you can put chemical potentials, you can put finite temperature. So there's quite a lot of beautiful physics also in that case. Okay, let me see. So I have 10 minutes. So maybe for the last 10 minutes, let me go back to the stuff which I know best. Which is actually, again, more of the D3, D7. Okay, so now let me go back to the D3D7 model. Sorry, was there a question? No. And so now we can also put D7 brain embeddings into the black hole background. And so as you see in that case, there's actually a very nice first order transition between this blue brain ending before it reaches the black hole and the case when it goes all the way to the black hole. And okay, so now this is very similar to what I was drawing here for the Constable-Myers, but now we don't embed the D7 brain in the Constable-Myers, but in the black hole background. And so in that case, you don't have a singularity here, but you have a horizon. So, and there's nothing wrong with brains ending on the horizon. And actually, there's a phase transition between high values of the quark mass, where again the brains are almost flat, and then the case when the brains actually end on this horizon. And the difference is that in this case, the mesons are stable. Okay, so the spectral functions are essentially delta peaks. But then when the brains end on the horizon and you then look at fluctuations, then some energy falls into the black hole, and then this means there's dissipation, and this means the spectral function, the particle decays, so there's a finite width of your meson. Okay, so first of all, the transition from here to there, you can actually see it's first order, you know, by zooming into this region. And it's a geometrical transition, because here on the horizon, as I said yesterday, the S1 shrinks to a point. Well, as in this case, there's this S3, this blue circle, which I always drew, which shrinks to a point. So there's a competition whether this S3 circle or the S1 circle shrinks first. And so that's the transition, this geometric transition between the two topologies. And it's first order. And so here we have stable mesons, and here we have decaying mesons. Okay, now we can make a connection to spectral functions. So as I explained now in great detail, the meson masses can be calculated from linearized fluctuations of the D7 brain embedding. So we make an ansatz for our fluctuation, which looks like this. And so the meson mass is given by minus the square of the 4 vector. And now for these black hole embeddings, this frequency here develops a negative imaginary part, which then means that we have some damping, and there's a decay width of these mesons. Okay, and again, we can make contact with the hydrodynamics I was explaining this morning. And as I said there, the spectral function is determined by the poles of the retarded Green's functions. And so these were also set by these quasi-normal modes, but these quasi-normal modes exactly are also our mesons, okay? So you can identify the mesons with resonances in the spectral function, because they come from the same origin on the gravity side. Okay, so essentially, the spectral function, which I already mentioned this morning, it's the retarded Green's function, and you can calculate it in precisely the way I explained this morning. The new thing which comes in here is that now we have a flavor current, which is dual to the gauge field on the D7 brain. So the new thing compared to what I was talking about this morning is that we now introduce this D7 brain, and then this means we have a flavor current, and for this flavor current, we can calculate the spectral function. And this gives us the resonance spectrum where the resonances correspond to the vector mesons. So these are precisely the room mesons I was talking about earlier. So if you remember yesterday, I showed you this very nice plot of some spectral functions. But before we can come back to that, there's yet one more thing I have to add, because we need to switch on a finite baryon density. And that's obtained by looking at the time component, so the zero component of the gauge field on the brain. And again, this has a leading and a subleading term. And according to this law, which I just brought up, ADS-CFT, the leading term now is the chemical potential, and the subleading term is the density, the baryon density. Okay. And now there's an interesting fact that when you switch on this baryon density, then all these seven brain embeddings, again, this is rho and W6 as before, then all the embeddings are black hole embeddings. There's no brains ending before reaching the black hole. They all actually connect to the black hole in the end. And so this means we can draw a phase diagram. So where here we have the temperature, and here we have the chemical potential. And essentially, it's both in units of the quark mass. So this is some renormalized quark mass here. In this region, the density is zero. That's where we have the Minkowski embeddings. And if we are outside this region, we have a finite baryon density, and we have the black hole embeddings, and our mesons become unstable. So, and these curves is because I'm going to show you some spectra where we run along these curves. Okay, so this is how exactly you calculate this green function now for the spectral meson. And okay, so one has to use some particular gauge invariant quantities, so there are some technical details. And so after Fourier transforming, that's how you get your electric field components. And then you can show that the green functions are given by this expression, where again, rho is now a very similar code. The rho is again this coordinate which are wrapped off in the 4, 5, 6, 7 direction. Okay, so, and as we calculated already some time ago, now you get lots of beautiful spectral functions, and this chi essentially determines the quark mass again. It's just a parameter dialing the quark mass, and so in the temperature-dominated regime, if we go back to our phase diagram, means that we are somewhere out here, okay, or out there. Now, then, if we, from here, if we start here and then run around this line, we get closer and closer to this region where the mesons actually become stable. Okay, so if we are far, very far away, we get these very wide resonances. Okay, people sometimes ask, why is this negative? It's because I subtract the value of the spectral function without any resonances inside. Okay, and okay, so then when we go to the region very near to this phase boundary, then our resonances become much sharper. And when we get very, very close, it becomes almost this, at least the lowest order one becomes almost a delta peak. And of course, the higher order ones are slightly broader. Okay, so, and so this, when you are here, this means that in our phase diagram, we sit at this point, and we are almost in this Minkowski embedding region, and in the Minkowski embedding region, you can calculate these meson masses analytically. I mean, just in the same way as I introduced in the first 1 hour and 15 minutes of this lecture. And then, so actually, the positions of these peaks precisely agree with the supersymmetric spectrum. Okay, and then this is what I showed yesterday. Now, if we go to finite density, so and dial the quark mass to be a particular value, and then change the density, we see that this peak becomes flatter and moves to the right, which then yesterday compared to this previously obtained field theory result. As somebody pointed out correctly yesterday, okay, their result here is in the vacuum, but in our case, in the vacuum, this just becomes a delta peak. Okay. Well, I'm dead on time. Okay, so it's okay. The background is slightly simpler than this one, but nevertheless, what I think is interesting is that increasing the density makes the peak broader and the maximum moves to the right, so which occurs in both models. Okay. Okay, I'm out of time, so let me just quickly say what I won't. So I had prepared some section on, because there was these very nice lectures by Edmond Yanku and about small x also. And so there's many things you can do in ADS-CFT about this as well. And so I have some set of notes about this, but now I don't think I have time to go through that anymore. So, but you can have hard scattering, you can have, different kinds of Pomerons, and there's some really, really nice. You can derive the Froissart bound from ADS-CFT if you want. And so there are some really nice things which I won't have time to talk about this time, but maybe you are come to the conclusion that all of this is actually pretty interesting, and there are many, many possibilities, and there are still many, many things which we haven't done. Okay, so maybe let me conclude in 30 seconds. So I showed you what gauge gravity duality is. So it's a new duality between a quantum field theory without gravity and a quantum theory with gravity. And apart from this fundamental of relation of being related to string theory and finding a theory of unified theory of all interactions, it's also a new approach for describing strongly coupled systems. Okay, I showed you some of the examples which I wrote here, transport, hydrodynamics, non-equilibrium, Mesons. I didn't talk about Gloobos. You can also do Gloobos in these backgrounds, and then it's without the probe mines. Wilson loops, deep inelastic scattering, and there's still many, many things which we haven't thought of doing, and certainly it's one more tool in our toolbox of looking at strongly coupled systems. And at the same time, it provides lots of new, fresh looks at the nature of gravity, which is also very interesting. So I hope you had also a little bit of fun in these lectures, and you learned a few things, and you're interested at looking at these things further in the future. So I certainly put my slides online so you can start from there. And there's some references also. Okay, I'm also sorry that I'm not speaking very loudly anymore, but I think my voice now completely died. So I'm glad I made it to the end. Okay, thanks for your attention.
Questions?
So this detailed is your baryonic density, right?
Yes.
So, I mean, can you just explain a little bit what those line exactly stands for?
Okay. So the phase transition, there's two phases in this diagram, okay? So essentially, it's a diagram with temperature and chemical potential. Then we have this gray region in which the density is zero. And we have another region in which the density is non-zero. And these other lines, they have nothing to do with the phase diagram. These are just lines which I have drawn there because we move along them when I go from this curve to that curve to those curves. So here you see I have these four spectra where the peaks become narrower and narrower. And this is just obtained by moving, I think, along this curve. So I pick this blue curve. And all the four diagrams I show to you correspond to a point on this blue curve. And the closer I get to this corner, the closer I get to the gray region. Now, in this gray region, the embeddings of the brain are such that, okay, so you know you have this eight-dimensional object, and it wraps an S3 in this internal space, and it wraps an S1, which is the compactified temperature. And both of them shrink when you move from the boundary of the anti-de Sitter space to the inside. But depending on the parameters, one of them shrinks faster than the other. If we are in the gray region of the phase diagram, it means we are in this region where the gray, where the S3 shrinks faster than the S1. This means that your brain ends, because if this S3 shrinks to a point, it just means you can't go any further in the radial direction. I mean, you have to turn around again. It's a bit similar than you know, in the Sakai Sugimoto, there's this RKK coordinate, what's happening there. You know, there's a circle shrinking to a point. This means you can't go further in this radial direction. You have to come back. And but if you are in the white region of the phase diagram, this is the region where these brains end on the horizon. And in that case, the mesons are unstable because here, you know, so the fact that this in these spectral functions, we have a finite width. So here, the finite width comes from the fact that I looked at the fluctuation of a D7 brain, which ends on the black hole background. So if it fluctuates, some of the energy falls into the black hole, and then it dissipates. And this dissipation gives me an imaginary part to my eigenfrequencies, and that determines the width of these curves, these spectral curves. And okay, so basically I have a region of zero density where the mesons are stable, and I have a region of non-zero density where the mesons are unstable.
I see.
So this I can study, and okay, so, and then...
So I mean, to be specific, what I was really asking for, since your phase diagram is also in this TMU plane, so some way or other, whether you can get some analogy with the QCD phase diagram in the TMU plane?
In principle, yes. The only thing here, I'm still in a slightly simpler version because everything I'm doing here is in the deconfined phase. So if I look at this black hole embedding, I don't have confinement. Everything is deconfined.
See.
So all these phase diagrams and transitions which you see here, they are in the deconfined region. So if you want to get closer to the QCD phase diagram, you have to combine the deconfinement transition with these transitions at finite density. I mean, it's certainly interesting that here that we can do many, many things at finite density, which normally are not so easy to calculate. I think in the Sakai Sugimoto model, maybe, Tony, do you know anything about this? Did people study the phase diagram of the Sakai Sugimoto in the mu t plane and compare with the quark gluon plasma?
Yeah, there have been calculations done like this, but the thermodynamics is not really correct because the model is then revealing its five-dimensional nature. So it, all the scalings is just wrong.
Okay, so then, thanks. So then, what I should say is that in principle, it should be possible to do something in this gravity context to model the phase diagram. However, you need to include both, as Tony was just saying, the confinement deconfinement transition and the fact that you dial the chemical potential and the density. And that, so all the models we have so far are probably a little too simple. And so essentially, one would have to have a model which combines the features of this Constable Myers together with this black hole model, but that doesn't exist.
Right. Mm-hmm. Thanks.
So you made some comment regarding this quasi-normal mode frequency and this resonance. Can you repeat that? I mean, I just...
Yes, okay. So... did I say anything about quasi-normal mode? Yeah, okay, you know, here. Okay, so... I talked at length about the fact that we can calculate meson masses from these fluctuations. And so far, everything I showed you for this Constable Myers was done at zero temperature. And then all the mesons are actually stable. They're just, the spectral functions are just delta peaks. Now, the interesting thing is if you put a black hole in your space and these brains actually end on the black hole, and if you allow again for the fluctuations, some energy falls into the black hole. And this means that the eigenmodes of these fluctuations, they become complex. So this is said here, this frequency here develops a negative imaginary part. Now, if this is negative imaginary, yeah, because there's another I here, then you have something like e to the minus omega t. And then there's a damping, okay? And the damping will lead to a finite width in the spectral function. And now there's this really nice relation between these fluctuations and the calculation of the Kubo formula, because the spectral function will be determined by the poles of the retarded Green's functions, but the poles are exactly given by these complex eigenmodes. And these are called the quasi-normal modes. So this is a very important concept. I mean, quasi-normal modes normally describe you the vibration modes of black holes even in the universe and of real black holes. But here we have these vibrations of a black hole in anti-de Sitter space, and these Koppnick's eigenfrequencies develop explain the peak position and the width of these peaks in the spectral function. So that's a very useful and important concept, which so you can these gravity eigenmodes determine your field theory spectral function. Rob has one.
I just wanted to comment that in 2007, Mark Van Romsdank looked at the Sakai Sugimoto model.
I didn't.
In 2007, Van Romsdank and collaborator looked at the Sagai-Sugimoto model at finite density.
Yes.
And found instability to spatially in the homogeneous phases.
Yes. Okay. So I think that's what probably Tony was also saying. The thing is just it doesn't look quite the same as the QCD phase diagram.
Why doesn't it look?
I meant that quantitatively the thermodynamic quantities come out incorrect. But there have been studies also of inhomogeneous phases in the Sakai-Sugimoto model, so something like chiral spirals can be studied there. So qualitatively, at least, one can reproduce things.
But what's wrong in detail? I didn't.
What?
What's wrong in detail? You say thermodynamically it's incorrect.
Well, if you look just at how pressure scales with temperature and chemical potential, the powers are wrong. Because the model is revealing an extra dimension.
Yeah, thanks for the comment. So, anything else?
So.
Well, I should say I'm still here on Monday. So, if you have still urgent questions, you can still ask me till Monday. Okay. Thanks. Sorry.
So, if there aren't any questions, so let's thank Johanna for a wonderful set of lectures. Just going. Thank you.